حديث نمبر 128 ما شاء الله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين، والعاقبة للمتقين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وإمام المتقين، وعلى آله وأصحابه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. وقال سبحانه وتعالى: وإذا حييتم بتحية فحيوا بأحسن منها أو ردوها. وقال سبحانه وتعالى: قل يا عبادي الذين أسرفوا على أنفسهم لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله، إن الله يغفر الذنوب جميعا، إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: من صلى علي صلاة واحدة صلى الله عليه أشرا. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: إذا دخل الرجل بيته فذكر الله عز وجل عند دخوله وعند طعامه قال الشيطان: لا مبيت لكم ولا عشاء. وإذا دخل فلم يذكر الله عند دخوله قال الشيطان: أدركتم المبيت. وإن لم يذكر الله عند طعامه قال الشيطان: أدركتم المبيت والعشاء. أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام: رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا، إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. يا رب العالمين، زدنا علما بالقرآن العظيم وبسنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. الحمد لله. Today is the 128th lesson of Al-Adab al-Mufrad. It is only through the sheer mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that now for the last consecutive 128 Fridays now we have been discussing the work of Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayh. There are approximately 1,300 ahadith inside this work, Al-Adab al-Mufrad. And from them 1,300 hadith, we have reached up to today 1,095 hadith. So may Allah ta'ala accept these last 127 lessons. Hazrat Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi wants to continue to talk about when we enter homes, how should we enter our house? How can we expect peace to come into our homes, into our lives? Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi will explain this. Hazrat Imam Bukhari says, وَبِي قَالَ أَمِيرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ فِي الْحَدِيثِ أَبُو عَبْدِ اللَّهِ مُحَمَّدْ بِنْ إِسْمَاعِيلِ الْبُخَارِيُّ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا مُحَمَّدٌ بِنْ مَقَاتِلٍ قَالَ أَخْبَرَنَا عَبْدُ اللَّهِ قَالَ أَخْبَرَنَا إِبْنُ جَرِيجٍ قَالَ أَخْبَرَنِي أَبُو الزُّبَيْرِ أَنَّهُ سَمِعَ جَابِرًا رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُ يَقُولُ إِذَا دَخَلْتَ عَلَى أَهْلِكَ فَسَلِّمْ عَلَيْهِمْ تَحِيَّةً مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ مُبَارَكَةً طَيِّبَةً قال ما رأيته إلا توجيه قوله وإذا حييتم بتحية فحيوا بأحسن منها أو ردوها. Hazrat Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi says he heard from his teacher Muhammad bin Maqtal, who heard from his teacher Abdullah, who heard from his teacher Ibn Jurayj, who had heard from his teacher Abu Zubayr rahimahullahu ta'ala, who was blessed to hear from the companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Jabir radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, who says that when you enter your home, when you enter your house, فَسَلِّمْ عَلَيْهِمْ, then give salam to all those inside that house. تَحِيَّةً مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ مُبَارَكَةً طَيِّبًا. Give them salam. What is this salam? It is good news from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a means of barakah. It is a means of pure good barakah for your home. Jabir radiallahu ta'ala anhu then says that I do not see this statement of Jabir, but that it is the explanation of the verse of the glorious Quran, the book of Allah, where Allah Ta'ala says, وَإِذَا حُيِّيتُم بِتَحِيَّةٍ, that if some of you give salam, then give salam fahayyu bi ahsana minha. If you are given salam to, then reply with something which is better than that salam, or rudduha, or at least reply the same. So if someone says to you assalamu alaykum, then at least say back to them wa alaykum assalam. But it is better for you to say assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, to give something better. From this we understand that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's companion Jabir, he is teaching me and you a very important lesson. That lesson is that, you know, me and you, we want goodness in our lives. We want it so that people do good to us, that in our lives we receive goodness, in our family, private life, everything's okay. So one of the greatest ways to allow that, to allow the spark of goodness, the spark of barakah in our lives, between our family members, husband and wife, father, child, between parents, between siblings, one of the greatest ways is that when you enter your home, then start off with salam. Then enter the house with the salam. Because salam actually means peace, it means barakah, it means blessings. So as soon as you enter your home with salam, then indeed you've already set the atmosphere, you've set the environment where the mercy of Allah can descend. So here, a very important point for me and you. So when we enter our homes, why should we give salam? Why should we enter our houses with the name of Allah? Why should we give assalamu alaykum? Why should we say bismillah? Why should we mention Allah? Imam Bukhari explains this with the next hadith. وَبِي قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا خُلَيْفَ قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا أَبُو عَاصِمٍ قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا إِبْنُ جُرَيْجٍ أَنْ أَبِي الزُّبَيْرِ أَنْ جَابِرٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُ أَنَّهُ سَمِعَ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَقُولُ. Imam Bukhari is so clever. Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi, in the previous hadith, he mentions the statement of Jabir radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, who is a companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who says to me and you that when you enter your home, make sure you give salam, make sure you enter your home with peace. So now Jabir radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, where did he learn this from? Who taught him this method of entering the home to give salam? Imam Bukhari mentions the next hadith wherein he relates from his teachers until he comes to Jabir, but this time Jabir says he has heard from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What did Rasulullah say? إِذَا دَخَلَ الرَّجُلُ بَيْتَهُ, when a person enters his home, فَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ عِنْدَ دُخُولِهِ, he remembers Allah whilst entering his home, and وَعِنْدَ طَعَامِهِ, and when he is about to eat and sit to eat, he remembers Allah. He remembers to say Bismillahi wa ala barakatillah. He remembers to say the masnoon du'as. قال الشيطان, then Shaitan says, لا مبيت لكم ولا عشاء, that oh my workers, oh shayateen, there is no space for you to stay in this house today. Because this person has entered his home with the name of Allah. Wherever the name of Allah is mentioned, then Shaitan does not enter that place. ولا عشاء, Shaitan continues to say, وَإِذَا دَخَلَ فَلَمْ يَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ عِنْدَ دُخُولِهِ, Shaitan says that now that this person before eating has said the name of Allah, he said Bismillah. وَلَا عَشَى, that oh shayateen, oh my helpers, Shaitan, there's no food for you in this house either. You will not be able to take a share from the food of this person, because he started his food with the name of Allah Ta'ala. But when a person enters his home, فَلَمْ يَذْكُرُ اللَّهِ, but he doesn't mention Allah. He forgets to mention the name of Allah. Before he eats, he doesn't say the name of Allah. So Shaitan says, قَالَ الشَّيْطَانِ أَدْرَكْتُمُ الْمَبِيتِ, oh Shayateen, come! We have found a place where we can spend the night here today. Because this person entered his home without mentioning Allah. So we will find peace, we will find refuge in this house. وَإِنْ لَمْ يَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ عِنْدَ طَعَامِهِ, when a person does not mention Allah whilst eating, قَالَ الشَّيْطَانِ, Shaitan also says at that moment, أَدْرَكْتُمُ الْمَبِيتِ وَلَعَشَى, though enter this home, not only have we found this house where we can rest and spend the night, we can also take part in the food of this house. Because this person did not mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's name, so there is no barakah in the food, so Shaitan takes part in that food. So Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi is saying to me and you that look, the reason why I'm emphasizing this, why I'm telling you that when you enter your home, if you want to solve problems at home, start with salam. Give salam to your parents, give salam to your spouse, give salam to your children. give salam to your siblings. Why? Because I'm telling you, by mentioning Allah's name, you've already taken away shaitan from your house. So the only thing that you have to deal with is now your own personal arguments. Shaitan won't play a part in them arguments. So let's at least do that much and take shaitan away from the picture. Let's take shaitan away from our problems. So he, Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi, he gives me and you a very beautiful way, a very beautiful prescription to save ourselves from shaitan. So next time we enter our homes, we should make it a point that whilst entering our homes, we give salam, we mention Allah Ta'ala's name, that we, before we start to eat, we say Bismillah, at least we say Bismillah, we praise Allah whilst eating also. Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi now wants to mention that, you know, sometimes is the case, many non-Muslims, those that are not Muslims, they also learn the salam. They learn to say assalamu alaikum. The accent might not be the best, but they still learn to say the salam. So now the question is, if a non-Muslim is giving me and you salam, how should we react? Should we ignore it? Should we reply by saying something? What is the teaching of Islam at this junction? So he, Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi, explains. وبه قال حدثنا أحمد بن خالد قال حدثنا محمد بن إسحاق أن يزيد ابن أبي حبيب أن مرثد أنا بالبصر الغفاري عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إني راكب غدا إلى يهود. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to his companions that tomorrow I'm going to go visit a Jewish person, a Jewish man. This is in Medina Munawwara. فلا تبدأهم بالسلام. And the companions are gonna follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So Rasulullah gives instructions to his companions. Rasulullah says to his companions, فلا تبدأهم بالسلام. That when I go meet this Jewish man, you people do not be the first to give salam. Let's listen to the saying of this Jewish man first. Depending on what he says, we will reply. So don't. When we meet him, don't go and give salam to him first. Because this salam is special and specific to Muslims. This is the greeting of a Muslim to another Muslim. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said this to his companions, فَإِذَا سَلَّمُوا عَلَيْكُمْ فَقُولُوا وَعَلَيْكُمْ. If this person gives you salam, then reply to him saying, وَعَلَيْكُمْ. That's all you have to say. Don't say wa alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Just reply this much by saying wa alaykum. There are different reasons why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this, but the most accepted reason is the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew that the Jews of Medina of that time, they weren't happy with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They weren't happy that Islam was flourishing. They weren't happy that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was becoming so accepted in Medina Munawwara, because many Jews lived there before Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam came. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew that they were still hostile with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When they used to give salam to Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they didn't give salam. They used to say in Arabic, not assalamu alaikum. They used to say to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, assalamu alaikum. And the word sam in the Arabic language means death, means destruction. It comes in the meaning of halak, of the, may destruction be upon you, may you be destroyed, may death come to you. So Rasulullah knew that they don't reply with this. They don't reply with salam. So the best thing, rather than giving any aggressive reply back, rather than being aggressive, rather than starting a fight, the best thing is wa alaykum. Whatever you have said to us, and may that be upon you. So if a person did actually give peace to you, then may peace be upon that person also. If they wished destruction upon you, then may destruction be upon them. So Rasulullah explained that, look, you don't need to say anything extra. No, leave it be. If they give you salam, if they give you death and, you know, a curse, it doesn't matter. Just say wa alaykum. Once this incident took part in front of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam was with his wife, Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, and a group of Jews met Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And they said to the Messenger of Allah, assalamu alaykum, meaning they covered the lam in the Arabic language, meaning may death be upon you. When Aisha radiallahu ta'ala heard this, she became very angry. She said, O Messenger of Allah, did you not hear? She said to them, Wa alaykumul la'na, may curse be upon you. May the curse of Allah be upon you. So Rasulullah said to Aisha, Aisha, no. Aisha said, O Messenger of Allah, did you not hear what they said to you? They said to you, Assalamu alaykum, may death be upon you. They cursed you. So Rasulullah replied to them saying, Wa alaykum. So then Rasulullah said to Aisha, "Oh Aisha, it doesn't matter what they said to me. Did you know? Did you not hear what I said back? I just said wa alaykum, and I left it at that. I didn't curse back. I didn't curse back because it doesn't make it okay. If someone is doing wrong to you, doing wrong back to them doesn't make it okay. If someone treats you in a way that it's not accepting, that you're not happy with, it doesn't make it okay for me and you to treat that person back with that same sort of way that, you know, being cruel to them. Just because someone's not kind to me and someone's not doing goodness to me doesn't mean I can't give back to them." There's a very beautiful saying that just because a person is cruel and they are exercising the quality of being bad to a person, that's more of an excuse for me to be exercising my good character. That when someone is doing wrong to me, then I should be making that extra point to be better to them. The ulama explain that there are three types of people. One type of person is that person, if you do bad to them, then they will do bad back to you. For example, the example that the ulama explain is, if someone slaps you, then there are some people that by getting one slap, they'll give back two slaps. Second type of person is that person that if you do wrong to them, i.e. you slap them, then they don't slap you back and they leave you be. But what was the character of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ, that you've got the best of character. What's the best of character? The third type of person. That person that when someone does wrong to them, i.e. someone gives them a slap, so they don't just do nothing, they say to the person that has caused them grief, so i.e. if someone has given you a slap, then the character of Rasul was that if someone was to give him a slap, Rasulullah would say, that is your hand okay? Is your hand okay? Did you feel pain by giving me a slap? Did you feel any sort of hurt by trying to hurt me? Did you go out of your way to hurt me? You know, when someone's trying to hurt you, that, you know, was it difficult for you to hurt me? This was the approach of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And this is such a level of taqwa, such a level of piety and character that a person needs to work on. It's not easy. If someone does wrong to you, automatically you know this much, that if you're not going to do wrong back to them, you have this malice inside you, this feeling like, oh, he's done wrong to me. We might spill from the tongue and talk bad of that person. It's really hard. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in every situation, he was such a person that someone does wrong to him, he replies back to that person with goodness. So may Allah make me and you such people that when people do wrong to us, we repel it with goodness. If someone wants to cause me harm, I become a means of peace for that person. If someone speaks ill of me, I speak good of that person. May Allah make us among such people. حضرت امام بخاري says, وبه قال حدثنا عمرو بن عاصم قال حدثنا حمام قال حدثنا قتادة عن انس رضي الله تعالى عنه قال انس رضي الله تعالى عنه says that مر يهودي على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, that a Jewish man, he walked past Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, فقال السلام عليكم, he said to the messenger of Allah, that may death be upon you, فرد اصحابه السلام فقال قال السلام عليكم. The companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when they heard this, they didn't hear him properly. So they said, wa alaykum as-salam. They replied saying to this person, wa alaykum as-salam. The Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, this man did not say to you, as-salamu alaykum. This man said, qala as-salamu alaykum, that may death be upon you. Fa'akhadha al-yahudiyya fa'tarafa. The messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he stopped that person. And he said to him, to this Jewish man, that did you not say assalamu alaykum? Did you not wish death upon me and my companions? Isn't that what you said? فَأْتَرَفَ, that man accepted and said, yes, I meant harm to you. قَالَ رَدُّوا عَلَيْهِ مَا قَالَ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to his companions that he wanted harm to you. He wanted to give you harm. Reply back to him by saying to him, وَعَلَيْكُمْ, and hope for guidance for that person. So this was the way of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. That at least say this much, that wa alaykum, leave it be. For Rasulullah said, wa alaykum, and say to these people, that may guidance be upon you. So from this we understand the approach of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, an approach that me and you need to take. That look, here now today isn't a climate, it isn't a time that you go against, there isn't a time where you, just because someone does wrong to you, that you shout back. Makes no difference. By me shouting and you shouting, we're both shouting. It doesn't help the situation.
the situation is helped sometimes by silence. Sometimes silence speaks louder than a shout. Sometimes it just takes someone to be quiet, and that has a greater effect than those that are shouting. Sometimes a whisper is better heard than a shout, because a whisper is more clearer than a shout. So maybe we should think of that approach. Maybe we should think of these things, that whenever anyone, friends, family, those that may not have the best of feelings for us, anyone wants to do me and you harm, then let's at least reply back with peace. Let's at least reply back with goodness. May Allah make us among such people. Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhumah, who was the great commentator of the Quran al-Kareem, amongst the companions, there were some that had great, great qualities. For example, Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was known to be the master of hadith, the one that has narrated the most ahadith from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Ibn Abbas is that companion who was known to be Amirul Mufassirin, the leader of all of those that commentate on the glorious Quran. So Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhumah, he's going to explain the verse, وَإِذَا حُيِّيتُم بِتَحِيَّةٍ فَحَيُّوا بِأَحْسَنَ مِنْهَا أَوْ رُدُّوهَا. That if someone gives you salam, then you give salam something better, or at least reply with the same. Meaning if someone says assalamu alaykum, you reply saying wa alaykum assalam. Ibn Abbas wants to explain a point now. Ibn Abbas wants to say to me and you, he's got a different approach. He wants to say, وبه قال حدثنا محمد بن الصبا قال حدثنا الوليد بن أبي ثور عن سماك عن إكرمة عن ابن عباس رضي الله تعالى عنهما قال رد السلام على من كان يهوديا أو نصرانيا أو مجوسيا. Ibn Abbas رضي الله تعالى عنهما says, if anyone gives you a good word, anyone, they don't have to be a Muslim. Someone says a good word to you, i.e. someone says good morning to you. They're not Muslim, they don't know the greeting of Islam. They say to you good morning. Ibn Abbas says radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, that reply back with goodness also. To the extent, be it a Jew, be it a Christian, be it a person who worships idols, but they are giving you a good greeting, a greeting of good morning, a greeting of how are you, I wish you the best, seasonal greetings, then reply back with them with good greetings also. Ibn Abbas says, "Dalika." This is because bi anna Allah Taala, because Allah has said in the glorious Quran, "Wa idha huyitum," that when someone gives you salam, and Allah has not specified that if a Muslim gives you salam, Allah says, if anyone gives you salam, fahayyu bi ahsana minha, then give them a better greeting. And if you can't give them a better greeting, أَوْرُدُّوهَا, at least give them the same greeting. So if a Muslim says to you, assalamu alaikum, say back to that person, wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. If a non-Muslim says to you, good morning, say to them, good morning, and I hope you have a very good day. If a non-Muslim says to you that I wish you a very good holiday, say to them, I wish you a very good holiday, and I hope you're kept safe and sound. I wish the best for you and your family. Say something extra. Be extra nice. This from the teachings of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the teachings of Ibn Abbas, and the teachings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If anyone gives you a good word, then give back to them goodness. You know, me and you, one of the reasons why we can't give back goodness to people, and it's the reality, I'm going to be very honest with you. One of the reasons why we find it hard to be good to people is because there's a deficiency inside me. It's not a deficiency inside someone else. If someone gives me and you a good greeting, or someone, anyone, a stranger, and we find it hard to reply back to them. Someone in the past has done wrong to me and you, and now after so many years they've come to me and you, and they've tried to, you know, put aside the mistakes and the problems of the past, and they've given you greetings of salam, they've met you in a gathering and you've spoken, and they're being good to you, and you're finding it hard to be good back, then the deficiency isn't in that person. The deficiency must be inside me. It must be me that's at fault. There must be something inside me that's stopping me from giving back a good reply, from me being good back, from me not forgetting the past. You know, when you have arguments and, you know, even though you're in the wrong, but you find it hard to say sorry, when you know for a fact that maybe I pushed the line, maybe in that argument I was at fault. But why am I still finding it hard to say sorry? Because maybe there's something inside me that's stopping me. Maybe I need to recheck my goodness. In reality, how much goodness have I got in my life? And being the month of Ramadan, the most glorious month of the Islamic calendar, the month wherein Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises a person that just by fulfilling one compulsory action, i.e. one fard, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards you for completing 70, minimum 70 fard in other times. Just by doing one optional act, a nafil, a nawafil, a mustahab, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you the reward as though that you have fulfilled one fard act. You know, I don't think we really understand what fard act actually means. There is a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam wherein Rasulullah says, if from the time of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, there would be a person, from that time till the day of Qiyamah, a person was to busy himself in nawafil, in optional prayer, in optional acts. And there is a different person who fulfills one fard of Allah Ta'ala, then the one who has fulfilled one fard is far greater than that person who spent the time from Adam alayhi salam till the day of Qiyamah fulfilling nafil and optional acts. This is one fard salah. And just by doing one nafil act in this month, you are given the reward of at least one fard salah, one fard, one compulsory act of Islam. This is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we can keep our buckets, you know, upside down to allow the rain of mercy, the mercy of Allah Ta'ala to descend. We need to have our buckets positioned the right way. And one grave misconception that many people have is, I've done so much wrong. You know, I've done so much wrong. How can Allah Ta'ala forgive me? How can Allah Ta'ala ever accept me? I've done so many wrong things in my life. Why will Allah accept me? Why will Allah forgive me? You see, a person should never become despondent in the mercy of Allah. Imam Al-Jawza'i rahimahullah ta'ala says that when the last 15 days of Ramadan start, and now that you're going down the hill, that it's over now, it's counting down. For some people are excited over Eid. Many people are there wishing that Eid comes, Eid preparations are being made. But this is the part of the race, this is the part of the moment where you need to just give that last part, as much as you can, that last sprint, that last energy, that stamina that you've got remaining, you need to pull through. Because there is still hope. A person may have disobeyed Allah Ta'ala for the last 15 days, but there is still hope in these last 10 days of Ramadan. There is still hope for a U-turn. There is a very beautiful chapter mentioned by Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala in Riyadh al-Salihin, a great work of the great commentator of Sahih Muslim, Imam Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala. In this hadith, a hadith of Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, it is mentioned, Abu Sa'id radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, Al-Khudri radiyallahu ta'ala anhu says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned, so Rasulullah is trying to now attract the companions towards the mercy of Allah. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to his companions that there was a man from the people of the past. قَتَلَ تِسْعَةَ وَتَسْعِينَ نَفْسًا. He had killed 99 people. 99 people, killed them. Without any due right, he had killed 99 people. And after killing them, he realized. You see, everyone has that moment where they realize, look, I need to stop this. I need to turn back to Allah. And there are those fortunate souls that when they have that realization, they actually make that U-turn back. So here this individual, Rasulullah mentions, he killed 99 people. After killing 99 people, he went to the scholar of the time. And he said to him that, I have killed 99 people. I have killed them. I have done wrong. Such a grave, grave sin in the court of Allah. Killing is a grave sin. Taking the life of any human being, any innocent life, is a grave sin. Anyone's life, every human being, Muslim or non-Muslim, has a worth. And their life is very valuable in the sight of Allah Ta'ala. So to take anyone's life is a grave sin. This man had taken the life of 99 people. فَهَلْ لَهُ مِنْ تَوْبَةٍ. So he asked, is there any door of repentance for me left? That can I still turn back to Allah? A person who has taken the life of 99 people, is there still chance for me? So this person said, La, there's no chance for you, no chance. How can you expect Allah Ta'ala to forgive you? How can you expect Allah's mercy to come to you? That you have killed and you have done so much wrong. So on hearing this, this man wasn't happy. What did he do? He took the life of that person also. that you've given me such a news, then even if I've got no hope, then you giving me that news, I'm sorry, I'm not happy with that either. So your life isn't worth anything to me. And he took the life of that 100th person. Then he went to a person and said to him that, ala rajulin alimin, a person who has a very good understanding of deen, a person who has a very good understanding of deen, who has the knowledge of deen, of the religion of Allah, that look, I've killed 100 people. Is there any hope for me? Will Allah forgive me? So now this person says, yes, there is hope. But that hope will come to you if you travel to a distant land. If you go to a such a such a land, kada wa kada, fa inna biha unasan, there are some people there, ya'budun Allah azza wa jal, they busy themselves worshipping Allah. You'll find good company, you'll find good friends there. Go to that area and there is hope by spending time with these people, you will also repent to Allah and Allah will forgive you. So this person, he started to go, and whilst going, atahul maut, death came to him. Death came to him. Time was up. Time was up. But he made that journey. He made that start. فَاخْتَرَسْمَتْ فِيهِ مَلَائِكَةُ الرَّحْمَةُ وَمَلَائِكَةُ الْعَذَابُ, the angels of mercy and the angels of punishment that were descending down, they started to argue. That who's going to take the soul of this man? He killed 100 people. So the angels of punishment that are coming with the punishment of Allah, so we are going to take him. We are going to take him and his abode will be Jahannam. And the angels of mercy are saying, no, but he has come towards goodness. He has made the step towards goodness. It just happened to be the case that death came to him. That's all it was, death came. But he realized before death, he made that move. What about him? So the angels are disputing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends another angel. فَأَتَاهُمْ مَلَكٌ فِي سُورَةِ آدْمِيٍّ فَجَعَلُوهُ بَيْنَهُمْ فَقَالْ قِيسُوا مَا بَيْنَ الْأَرْضَيْنِ. So this next angel comes and says that there's a very easy way to do this, a mathematical way, which is to measure the land. And the reality was, as mentioned in the hadith, that the reality was that this person had just made the initial steps towards this other village, this other town, where there are good people, good company, where he's going to change his life. But he was closer to his original hometown. He was closer to the place where he had killed 100 people. So he's closer to punishment. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as is the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah just looks for an excuse so that his mercy can be triggered. So Allah ta'ala, he had squished the land so that the person was closer to the village of the good people, to the good company, and was further away from his own hometown. So when the angels went to measure this, the angels of mercy find that he was closer to the place of mercy. And this became the means of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepting him. فَوَجَدُوهُ إِلَىٰ هَذِي أَقْرَبَ بِشِبْرٍ فَغُفِرَ لَهُ. He was closer just by a handspan. Just by a handspan he was closer. That was enough. فَغُفِرَ لَهُ. And his sins were forgiven. Forgiven. So this is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Nawawi rahimahullahu ta'ala mentions a very beautiful hadith here also. Such a beautiful hadith. Ya Allah, Ya Allah. Hadith of Sahih Muslim and Sahih Bukhari. Hazrat Abu Hurairah ibn Umar radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma mentions that I have heard Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam say, may Allah make us amongst those people that Allah becomes happy with. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, yudna al-mu'minu yawm al-qiyama min rabbihi, that there will be a servant of Allah on the day of Qiyamah, hatta yada'a kanafahu alayhi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make a screen for this one servant. Allah will exclude him from every other of his creation. That servant is excluded, a screen. Allah knows best what will be the means of this screen, but Allah will put a screen down. And it will be a conversation between Allah and only that servant. فَيُقَرِّرُهُ بِذُنُوبِهِ فَيَقُولُ. Allah will ask him, أَتَعْرِفُ ذَنَبَ كَذَا. O servant, do you accept that you did such a such a sin? أَتَعْرِفُ ذَنَبَ هَذَا. Do you also accept that you did such a such a wrong thing in the worldly life, in your worldly life? أَتَعْرِفُ ذَنْبَ هَكَذَا. Do you also accept that you did this wrong, that wrong, this wrong, that wrong? Allah will start to list every wrong that this servant of Allah did. Fayaqul, the person will say, after Allah asking him that, did you do this wrong, that wrong, this wrong, that wrong, this wrong, that wrong? Rabbi a'rifu. Oh Allah, I accept. Oh Allah, I confess. Yes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask, what excuse do you have? What excuse do you have that you went against me? So in this moment in time when you're in the court of Allah and you're excluded from the rest of the creation, you know, trying to make an excuse is a very difficult thing. This servant accepts that everything is his own fault. So he says to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Rabbi, a'rifu lima udhar. I don't have any excuse. I have done wrong, O Allah. I can't even pretend to make an excuse. I can't even lie my way out of this. I can't.
Qala, فَإِنِّي قَدْ سَتَرْتُهَا عَلَيْكَ فِي الدُّنْيَا.
Allah will say to this person, indeed, I definitely did not do this for you, that I covered your sins from the face of the people. No one knew that you used to do these sins. No one knew the details of your sins. The sins that you did in the darkness of the night, the sins that you did in mid-daylight, the sins that you did that everyone else thought that you were pious, everyone else thought that you were a good person. No one saw this. No one knew this. Only I. And I covered this from the creation, from every other person.
وَأَنَا أَغْفِرُهَا لَكَ الْيَوْمِ.
And today also, the way I have secluded you and I have excluded you and I have spoke to you in this manner, in that very same way, I am telling you in exclusion that even today, I'm not going to display your sins in front of the creation. Even today, I'm not.
وَأَنَا أَغْفِرُ لَهَا لَكَ الْيَوْمِ.
Today, I'm going to forgive you. فَيُعْتَى صَحِيفَةَ حَسَنَاتِهِ. And because of you confessing your sins to me, because of you accepting your wrong, all of the wrongs that you did, I will give you goodness in return for it. This is the way Allah SWT deals with some servants of His. But the reality is, that's for the day of Qiyamah. Now me and you need to think that my life and your life, I'm going to be very, very honest with you, every single person listening online, every single person in front of me, the reality is, I know my life better than any of you, and you all know your lives better than anyone. I know what sins I do. I know the times I trip up. And you also know in what ways you trip up. Be it with your dealings with the home, family life, private life, be it with your dealings with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with salah, with fasting, with sins. Every single person knows. And no one is here now to stand and explain all of their wrongs they've done in their life. Allah has kept it between yourself and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we should make it a point to also keep it like that. That we don't need to openly, publicly tell the whole world our sins. The way Allah has hidden it, we need to keep it hidden. But at the same time, we need to realize that we can't live this fake life. I'm sorry, it's not worth it. This fake life where in front of others we pretend to be so pious. That when we're outside with friends, yeah, so pious, so good. But at home, I'm a tyrant. At home, I can't even speak properly with my family members. You know, in front of people, brothers, I'm so kind to them. But when it comes to those that matter at home, I can't even speak with them with sweetness. But everywhere else, I'm so sweet. I'm talking to everyone, saying, you know, Abdullah bhai, and I'm saying, calling everyone brother, and I'm giving everyone salam, and I'm so good to everyone. But those that actually matter at home, how am I with them? Every single person knows their own way. And the reality is, if we don't turn back to Allah before Ramadan finishes, then we really need to ask ourselves, where are we going to go? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, a person who finds the month of Ramadan and he doesn't take it and he doesn't use it to turn back to Allah and to clear his sheet of sins and guna and wrong, then there's no other person more deprived than that person. So we can't let it be the case that I leave Ramadan after the next 11 days and Allah hasn't forgiven me. Let's not be amongst those people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the hadith of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that every single night Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives so many thousands of souls from the fire of Jahannam. He forgives so many to the extent on the last night of Ramadan, on the 29th or 30th night of Ramadan, Allah forgives that many servants as He did in the first 28 or the first 29 nights of Ramadan. Let it not be the case that we are not part of them, thousands. Thousands. So we need to turn back to Allah. And you know what turning back to Allah actually means? It means that a person has to realize that there is no other creator, there is no one else that I can turn to except for Allah. And the most best example for that is an incident that I've mentioned many times before. It's the incident of Shaykh Shibli, rahimahullahu ta'ala, who writes that once I went to do Umrah. Shaykh Shibli, rahimahullahu ta'ala, says, I went to do Umrah. And when I went to do Umrah, I was doing tawaf of the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as is the case, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sometimes He opens up certain things to certain servants that not general and normal servants experience. So Shaykh Shibli, whilst doing tawaf, he could hear there was a person doing tawaf saying, Labbaik, la sharika, labbaik, ya Allah, labbaik. Oh Allah, I am present. Oh Allah, I am present. Oh Allah, I am present. Shaykh Shibli could hear this man saying this in tawaf. He also could hear a voice saying, La labbaik, la labbaik. Your labbaik is not accepted. Your labbaik and your coming and doing tawaf is not accepted. So a voice is saying it's not accepted, and this man is saying, Labbaik ya Rabbi, labbaik la sharika, labbaik. So Shaykh Shibli, after doing tawaf, he stops and he's looking for this man. That I can hear a man say labbaik, and I can also hear a voice from the unseen saying, La labbaik. That your labbaik is not being accepted. So Shaykh Shibli, he looks around and he sees the man. That man who is saying labbaik, labbaik. So after he calls him, brother, what are you saying whilst doing tawaf? So the person says, I'm saying labbaik, la sharika lak, labbaik, that I am present. There is none worthy of worship but He, Allah. I am present in the court of Allah. So Shaykh Shibli asks him, that, do you hear anything in reply to your labbaik? Can you hear anything? So this person says, yes, I do. I hear a voice saying, La labbaik, that you're not accepted in my court. You're not accepted. You being in my court isn't accepted. So then Shaykh Shibli asks this person, and this is the point for me and you. Shaykh Shibli asks this man that, so you're saying to Allah labbaik, and you're getting the reply, La labbaik, you're not accepted in this court. So why are you asking from him? Why do you continue to ask? Why are you not stopping? Why are you asking still? Why are you still asking? So listen to this man's reply. He says, is there any other Lord? Is there any other Allah that I can go to? Is there any other creator that I can turn to? Is there any other Allah that I can go to that I can expect for that He can forgive me? That this other creator can forgive me? If there was any other Allah, maybe I could have gone to someone else, some other deity, and said, if Allah doesn't forgive me, then you forgive me. But there is no other Allah. So if He accepts me or He doesn't accept me, what can I do? He's my only creator. He's my only Allah. I don't have any other creator. I have to continue asking from Him. If I have to ask 1,000 times, then I'm going to have to ask 1,000 times until He forgives me. What can I do? I can't go to any other court. I have no other Allah that I can please, that I can turn back to. So Shaykh Shibli, astonished with this reply, this man continues to do tawaf. Labbaik la sharika lak, labbaik labbaik ya Rabbi. And now the reply comes, Labbaik ya Abdi, that your labbaik is accepted in my court, O my servant. Your labbaik is accepted. Why is it accepted? Because a person realizes that after every wrong I've done, after turning away from my creator so many times over, I can only go back to that one creator. I can't turn back to anyone else. I can't. And we all know our situation. Allah knows completely where I am with Him. I know how close I am with Allah and how far away I am from Him. So we can't kid anyone. If we're going to kid ourselves, then we're going to lose. So we have to accept and understand this much. That our only salvation is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our only way in success is turning back to Allah. And never ever become despondent in the mercy of Allah ta'ala. We have to turn back to Allah. We have to attach ourselves to Allah. There is a mention of, in the seerah of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, there was a young youth, and me and you being youth, this youth was very troublesome in the area of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, and he caused so much mischief. so much mischief that he started doing so much wrong, wrong after wrong after wrong, that everyone despised him, everyone hated him. That this person, he is too far. He has done too much wrong. So everyone said that you need to leave. You need to leave our town. If you don't leave, then there's going to be so much wrong coming to our town. And Musa alayhi salam is a prophet of Allah of that time. He also accepts that yes, if you don't leave, then we can't expect the mercy of Allah to descend. You've caused too much trouble. You do too much wrong. So this person, he leaves. And he goes to the jungle in the outskirts of the town. And because he's by himself, he starts to fall ill. And when a person is ill and he becomes weak, he realizes that strength does not lie with him. But strength lies from somewhere else, i.e. from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this youth, when realizing this, he makes a conversation with Allah. And this conversation is most beautiful of all of conversations. Ya Allah. This youth says to Allah, oh Allah, I am so rejected, I am so despised, that my own people have told me to leave. The people that I used to live around, they can't stand me. I am completely rejected. No one likes me. I have done so much wrong. My parents have left me. My friends have left me. Everyone hates me. And I am now today by myself. That now I am ill. There is no one here to help me. No one here to protect me. Oh Allah, and I am that person who has done so much wrong. But oh Allah, I am that rejected from the court of the people. But does that mean I am also rejected from you? So he starts to speak to Allah saying, oh Allah, your mercy. Are you saying to me that your mercy is so limited that because I have done so much wrong that I am deprived from your mercy, that everyone hates me and that now no one will accept me and now I will die in a state where you are displeased with me? Oh Allah, are you saying to me that your mercy is that limited and I have done so much sin that I have outdone your mercy? Oh Allah, are you saying that I am such a servant of yours that's not a word that you listen to? Oh Allah, isn't it okay that I am one servant and I am asking from that one creator? Oh Allah, I possibly couldn't have done that many sins that you can't forgive me. I have heard that your mercy is so wide. So with this conversation and with this attitude, he leaves the face of this earth. Hazrat Musa alayhi salatu wasalam is informed. Oh Musa, there is a certain friend of mine. Certain friend of mine. Not a certain servant of mine. Certain friend of mine. This friend of mine is such a friend that, oh Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, that if people take part in his janazah, in his salatul janazah, when they will bury him, whosoever takes part in the janazah of this friend of mine, I will forgive all of the attendees just for attending the janazah of this friend of mine. So Musa alayhi salam, enlightened, he tells the people that there is such a person in the outskirts who is staying. Allah Ta'ala has forgiven him. He is such a person that they don't know who he is yet. That he's a friend of Allah. He lives in the outskirts. If we all take part in the janazah, whoever takes part, Allah will also forgive them. So the people rush towards. The people rush towards the outskirts. And they find out, huh, it's this person, it's that youth. It's that man that we kicked out of our town. It's him who did wrong. How can he be the friend of Allah? So Musa alayhi salam asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah, is this that friend? Allah says, yes, this is my friend. He is such a friend of mine that the way he asked from me and the way he spoke to me and the way he argued about my mercy, if he was to at that moment ask for the whole of the creation, I would have forgiven the whole of the creation for his asking. Because this is the way he asked from me. He is my friend. He is that friend that turned back to me. So me and you, especially in Ramadan, let's make it a point, guys. Last 10 days, let's make it a point. You know, I feel very emotional. Do I feel emotional? Because I know my own state. Wallahi lazim. I don't need to say and I try to be fake and give you a bayan and try to explain to you, oh mashallah, I'm seeing this for yourselves. No. Wallahi lazim, I know my own state. I know how far I am from Allah Ta'ala. I don't know about your own, how far you are, how close you are. I don't know that. But I can tell you something about my own life. I know how far I am from Allah. I know what kind of sins I do also. So I need to turn back to Allah. We all need to. And don't waste Ramadan. The last 10 days are coming, those that made intention for i'tikaf. I'tikaf means the word akafa, comes from the word of seclusion. It means when you actually distance yourself from the world. It means when a person turns back to Allah. And the Islamic meaning is that when a person goes away from the creation and ilallah, and he turns, ruju ilallah, he turns towards Allah. So if we can't do i'tikaf, let's at least mentally do i'tikaf. Let's make our last 10 days where we're not wasting time. Where we're actually turning back to Allah. Make every excuse, every opportunity, every night, turn to Allah. Even if you can recite, ask Allah for forgiveness every single night, then you'll be amongst those servants that have asked Allah Ta'ala's forgiveness for 83 years. The night of power, if it happens to be, and you've asked every night, and it falls on the Laylatul Qadr, you're amongst those that have asked Allah's forgiveness for 83 years. Ask Allah for forgiveness. You know, the ulama say that when a person passes away, we always say, oh, may Allah have mercy upon him, may Allah give him Jannah. The greatest dua that we're all in need of is, may Allah forgive that person first. May Allah forgive that person, and then may Allah Ta'ala raise a person's status. So we need to turn back to Allah, every single person. Alhamdulillah, today, as everyone is aware, we've organized an iftar. And before the food and before we eat and everything, you know, there's about 20 minutes left. And I know those that are listening online too, it's very, very important that we learn to talk to Allah. And you know, talking, please don't ever, ever be mistaken to think talking to Allah means that you just raise your hands and you just say, Ameen, Ameen, Ameen. That is not talking to Allah. That is not called talking to Allah. Talking to Allah means where you talk to Allah. So if that means it's in English, then you talk to Allah in English. If that means it's in Bengali, then you talk to Allah in Bengali. If that means you can talk to Allah in Arabic, then you talk to Allah in Arabic. But you need to relate to Allah. You need to connect to Allah. Allah is a personal relationship. Allah Ta'ala, yes, His might is far and beyond. But Allah Ta'ala is very close to me and you. We have to have a personal relationship. And when you have a personal relationship, sinning becomes too hard. Disobeying Allah becomes hard. And when you do disobey Allah, you feel it. That I've just done wrong. Oh Allah, why did I do that? I've made you unhappy. You know, in front of our, if you are married, then you can't do certain things in front of your wife. You know that I can't be looking at haram in front of my wife. Because I love my wife. How can I do that? In front of my father, I won't do such a sin. Because that's my father. In front of my mother, I'll never dream of doing such a sin. But how? Because we don't have the realization of Allah, that's why we sin, that's why we trip. But the more you realize that Allah is with me all the time, Allah is my friend. Allah is your creator, but He's your friend also. Allah says, وَأَنَا عِنْدَ ظَنِّي عَبْدِي I am however my servant thinks of me. So if my servant thinks of me to be his friend, to be the most merciful, then I am the most merciful for him. I am his friend. Because we've kept Allah far beyond, and we think reaching Allah means dua and just saying Rabbana Atina. That's not Allah. It's a personal relationship. At every junction of your life, you learn to talk to Allah. When you trip up, you learn to go to the corner and you learn to cry and say, oh Allah, I've done wrong to you. Oh Allah, you said not to disobey you in this way, but I did. Please forgive me. Learn to cry in front of Allah like a baby. Learn to ask Allah, forget people, that I'm going to ask Allah in my way. So now if you're in your practice, you're having your suhoor, and before Fajr time commences, you know, take a time out. After food, before food, 5 minutes, go away, go to your room, sit there on your bed. Sit there and contemplate and think, oh Allah, I need to change my life. And it's a reality. If I pass away in a state where Allah is not happy with me, then I'm sorry to say there's not much hope. If Allah isn't happy with me, then I'm sorry. I can't lie to you, I can't lie to myself. I can't just pretend that, hey, I'm just doing every other wrong in my life, but hey, Allah's going to forgive me. It's not as simple as that. A believer, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, a believer, he doesn't fall in the same hole twice. He doesn't fall in the same hole twice. He doesn't be tricked twice. What does that mean? That you don't just think that, hey, I can just carry on doing wrong. A believer doesn't sin on purpose. He trips. He mistakenly sins. He forgets and then he sins. So we need to become such people that when we do wrong, we need to turn back to Allah. And turning back to Allah starts now, starts in Ramadan, and it starts from Ramadan for the rest of our lives. We will trip, we will make mistakes, no one's perfect. But after making the mistakes, quickly turn back to Allah. The ulama give the best example. If a person was to sin 100 times, and he was to ask Allah for forgiveness sincerely 100 times, and he passed away after that final 100th repentance, then that person will pass away in such a state that he has no bad sins in his book of deed at all. He will pass away sinless. So we need to turn back to Allah in that way. Alhamdulillah, from our Friday Hadith class, this opportunity has come about now where we can actually reflect. And the greatest time, Alhamdulillah, is Friday, the month of Ramadan, the third Friday of the month of Ramadan, the blessed time between Asr and Maghrib, when du'as are readily accepted. And in the month of Ramadan, du'as are always readily accepted. A time just before iftar, when du'as are accepted. A du'a in a congregation is accepted, meaning when people are sitting together and everyone making du'a, Allah's mercy descends. So even if you're not sincere in your du'a, just because another 2-3 more people are sincere, automatically that has an effect. Automatically Allah will accept you also. So Alhamdulillah, we've created such an environment. So with that in mind, inshallah, there's about 15 minutes left before the time of iftar. So I humbly request myself and us all, that if we can get into rows for salah, sit down, and everyone in your own way. You know, some will be raising their hands, some won't. However you feel comfortable to speak to Allah about your life, the way you are, where you're heading. Reflect, the how much of my life do I need to improve? What are the factors in my life that I need to change? Think it through, think to yourself, let's not talk to each other, let's just use these 15 precious moments, these 15 minutes, where we can turn back to Allah. And I make a vow to you, Wallahi al-Azim, I swear by Allah, if you are sincere in your repentance, however your repentance is, by words, by your mind, however you talk to Allah and you are sincere, I swear by Allah, that your sins will be forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of you being true to your repentance. So may Allah make us amongst those servants that they turn back to Allah in such a state that Allah ta'ala forgives all of their sins and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He accepts them. One final hadith, Ibn Adam, O the children of Adam, إِنَّكَ مَا دَعَوْتَنِي وَرَجَوْتَنِي, if you were to turn back to me, if you were to ask from me, غَفَرْتُ لَكَ عَلَى مَا كَانَ مِنْكَ وَلَا أُبَالِي, I will forgive you, I will not even ask you of the wrongs that you did. يبن آدم, لَوْ بَلَغَتْ ذُنُوبَكَ عَنَانَ السَّمَاءِ, O children of Adam, if your sins were to reach the heights of the heavens, ثُمَّ اسْتَغْفَرْتَنِي, thereafter you were to turn to me with true sincere repentance, غَفَرْتُ لَكَ وَلَا أُبَالِي, I will forgive you, I won't even ask regarding your sins. يبن آدم, O children of Adam, إِنَّكَ لَوْ أَتَيْتَنِي بِقُرَابِ الْأَرْضِ خَطَايَا, if you were to fill the whole earth with sins, ثُمَّ لَقِيتَنِي, thereafter you were to come to me, لَتُشْتِكُ بِي شَيْئًا, and you were to ask from me, and you were not to prescribe any partners to me, لَأَتَيْتُكَ بِكُرَابِهَا مَغْفِرًا, I will come back to you with the world full of forgiveness. O children of Adam, turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah ta'ala will forgive you. As is the saying of Imam Nawawi, rahimahullah ta'ala. May Allah make us amongst those people who are the true repenters. May Allah make us amongst those servants that when our time comes to leave the face of this earth, we leave in such a manner that Allah ta'ala is pleased with us. And Allah ta'ala grants us Jannatul Firdaus. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi. Astaghfiruka wa atubu.